Good afternoon to all the participants who are present right now. At the third session of today, we are having with us Mr. Kashyap Kansara, who is currently working in the Broadcom industry, Bangalore. Mr. Kashyap has done his graduation from Gujarat University in 2006, and then he has started his career with as an research assistant in the IIT Bombay. Then he has joined eInfochip Ahmedabad, and then he has worked with PLP, and right now he is working at Broadcom. So he is having vast experience of 15 plus years in the ASIC industry. He has worked starting from the RTL netlist to the GDSSI using Synopsys and Cadence and Apache and mentor tool chain and everything. If we are going to just go through the work experience of him in the domain of ASIC designing, then he is having his expertise in the design planning, die size estimation and optimization, then MFU optimization, working with the package stream, PNR flow enhancement, then correlation between PNR and sign off and low power implementation, placing and routing techniques, then custom CTS, CTA corner reduction, power layout verification, many other things. So up to now, in the career of around 15 years, he has successfully tapped out 18 plus chips contributed in that work. And currently he is leading the team for complete project cycle along with the critical task execution. So on behalf of Electronics and Communication Department, myself, Dr. Dhaval Bhojani, I heartily welcome you, Mr. Kashyap, as an expert of this session. And now I request you to hand over the session. So you can now start the sharing of your screen and you can interact with the participants. Just I want to let you know that how we are following the sessions up to now, that participants throughout the presentation would try to avoid interrupting you. They would be putting their questions in the chat box. Me and Koringa sir would be available during the session, and we would be going through the chat box, and we would be just interrupting you in between wherever it is a feasible time about the question of the participants, or we can have the question answer sessions at the end of the session also. So this would be will it be feasible, sir, for you?
That's fine. Otherwise, I'm open for interruption at any time. No problem.
Okay, sir. Okay. Because what would be happening, sir, whenever you are going to start presenting, then you would not be able to see your MS Team. So chat box would not be visible to you. So what we are doing is we are just going through the questions and we are delivering to you. Okay, sir.
Definitely. And even at the end of each and every slide, I'll let the audience speak out if they have any questions, so that at least their link is not broken. And I would appreciate if it becomes kind of interactive session rather than I'm just explaining the stuff. So yeah, any type of question, anything is perfectly all right. Don't be hesitant of anything, guys. I mean, you are all great achievers, and any kind of question is perfectly all right for me.
Okay, so welcome to the session, sir, and thank you for sparing your time. So it is over to you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sure. Let me start sharing then. Let me know, folks, once it's visible to you.
Yes, it is visible now.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I think you folks have already been through a lot of physical design implementation. And what I would like to give you is the main content for this session is sign-off. But just to have a better link with the complete design flow, I would briefly take you through the ASIC design flow, front end versus back end and physical design before we jump into the sign off checks. And in sign off checks, I'm planning to cover mostly four aspects. One is the logical equivalence check. Second is timing sign off. Third is the power verification. And fourth one is the physical verification. Okay. So I think this you must have already been through, like how it starts. I mean, let's say today we are taking lunch and we happen to just figure out that we want to have a chip that performs a certain amount of operations. Let's say it senses your heartbeats, it displays it, and you also want to make sure that it operates at a very low power. It's having a wonderful display, it's colorful. So these all becomes your specifications, right? I mean, out of the blue, if somebody thinks of a circuit which can capture market, then any of such idea is always appreciated, and people try to put that into actual working silicon, and then they try to capture market. So that's where the specifications come in, and the RTL designer or the architects who kind of get together and figure out what is most suitable into the current end markets. So specifications get translated into architectural designs. And once the architectural designs, all the specification, the requirements, everything is finalized, then the RTL coding and functional verification starts. So just to get a feeling of the real industry, when we say RTL coding, so 95% of coding is always reused from either the previous generation chips or from the existing SoCs. And then they are enhanced or sort of improved a little bit so that new features are added. Like it doesn't, you know, right, that you all have been using Intel processors, you all have been using Qualcomm mobile processor based smartphones. So if Qualcomm is kind of coming up with the latest Snapdragon, they are not designing it from scratch. So when that happens, let's say if a Snapdragon 845 or any other chip is there, it's a derivative from the previous generation. So what all things would change in that? So from the architectural standpoint of view, they would add some more functionality, some more gates will be added. Some of the redundant stuff will be taken out. And then most probably they would be migrating to the newer technology node as well. So if it's a 16 nanometer chip, it can go to 7 nanometer. If it's 7 nanometer, it can go to 5. Even it can go to 3 nanometer also. So many of the things are part of this specifications, and specs don't only define the functionality, but they also define other targets, like what is the supported frequency? Like everybody wants their mobile to work at super fast responsiveness, right? So do you want to play games on it? You want to play kind of multiple applications simultaneously, video calling, everything. So that those are some of the examples. So they are also part of the specifications. So, and along with that, these are the performance related requirement. And then there are some of the physical aspects also, like where this all things kind of get integrated, those boards, or what we call in real life is the modules, how much of power they can consume, what is the heat sink capability to kind of take out all the heat when the chip is in operational mode. So all this is part of the specification, and architectural design always keeps these things in mind. And based on that, the RTL coding starts. And coding is kind of a developmental process, but when you're developing something, you also need to make sure that whatever is being developed, that is in accordance to the specifications. So that's where RTL coding is the developmental process, and functional verification is the kind of backtracing or the checking process that the coding is in accordance to the specifications given or not. So architectural design, RTL coding, all these things, we are still in the logical domain only. So nothing has actually been translated. So once the developmental process reaches up to a certain threshold that it is good enough to kind of go to the next stage, then we kind of take it through the logic synthesis. And in the synthesis process, it actually gets converted from a logical design to the actual physical implementation. So you can see that the code displayed on the right side, once you synthesize it, becomes made up of all the gates, all the logic gates. So, and that's where the actual optimization kicks in. So logic synthesis being first part of the implementation, it is highly important that you give your best shot in order to choose the optimum most topology. You get best of the architecture so that you can meet your desired frequency. And of course, you get best of the power. So the Boolean optimization, the restructuring, all these things are taken into consideration once your RTL coding has kind of reached up to a certain maturity and you are proceeding to the logic synthesis. So once the synthesis is done, that's where a breakout comes in. So of course, it's a physically mapped gates, but still your optimization is more or less logical. And it has some sort of physical flavors, like it does have floor plan information, routing, everything. But still, it's a pretty early stage logic synthesis. And that's where you get a netlist out of the process. So that becomes your benchmark. So from this point onwards, your sign off starts actually, because if you do a logic synthesis and you write out a netlist from it, then first and foremost, you need to make sure that it matches to your RTL. And that's called the logic equivalence check between the synthesized netlist and the RTL, right? So this is the first process from where sign off starts. You need to have a flow that will take care of logic equivalence check, formal verification checks between the logic synthesized netlist and the RTL code which you have written, so that it guarantees that the synthesis process, when it mapped the Verilog or VHDL codes to the functional gates, it is still equivalent thing. Okay. And once that is guaranteed that it matches 100%, then the parallel branches start, like logic verification and a test insertion, like DFT. All those things get inserted, and then you proceed to the physical design. And in case of physical design, it's another vast topic. But once you go through the complete cycle of the physical design, then the physical verification, sign off, fabrication, packaging, testing, all those things take part, and then chip comes. So this is a huge cycle, which is kind of explained with a fewer words. So the cycles generally take 2 to 3 years for bigger chips. And for smaller SoCs, it still can take 1 to 2 years. So it's a big cycle demonstrated with a few number of steps, and it does involve a heavy investment. So any of the segment, it's extremely responsible staff for each and every individual involved in it, because if one of the segment goes wrong, then the complete investment turns out to be zero. So each and every engineer associated with any of the segments, it becomes his own responsibility to sign off the segment which he owns. Okay. So now the next slide, I'm going to kind of bifurcate physical design into a little bit more categories like front-end and back-end, so that we know the points from where the sign-off cycle starts. So before going to the next slide, the floor is open for you guys to have any questions.
No any questions, sir.
Okay. Then we'll move ahead. Okay. So now this is a kind of categorization of the circuit design done at different aspects like digital circuit, analog, and then front end versus back end. So I think you know that when RTL design starts, they kind of start verifying it before they do synthesis. That's where the simulations come in. So you know that you have written an RTL code for doing certain arithmetic operations. So then you also parallelly start simulating that code so that the kind of arithmetic operations which you have planned for, those are actually getting executed. So digital signal processing or any other kind of code about whatever is mentioned in the RTL, it's a purely a software thing. So software is there now, which is need to be kind of simulated so that you know that what is performance. And that's a parallel branch. And another parallel branch starts synthesizing it, what we just discussed so far. So there are differences between RTL simulation and gate level simulation. So gate level simulation is with the delay annotation. So it can be with the zero net delay as well as actual standard delay format based annotation using the gate level sims to get an appropriate measure of the functionality mentioned in the RTL. And of course, the formal check is the formal verification logic equivalence that the netlist matches to the RTL, just what we discussed in the previous slide. So this is one of the leg of the tree where digital circuit is getting designed. And in parallel, of course, a chip is never made of only digital circuitry. You need a lot of analog circuits as well, like you need SerDes, you need a lot of IOs, you need custom memories. So a lot of those things are also getting developed in parallel. And this analog and RF circuits, the design cycle for them is a little different because it's a schematic based. And then based on that, the analog HDL gets captured and that gets designed. So analog and radio frequency circuit design is a very well calibrated a design flow, which is not having flows like what we have in synthesis or physical design. So there it's mainly driven through the schematic design, although there is certain automation available now. But still, it is a very much involved process for the engineer owning those segments. And of course, simulation is part of any of the cycle, be it digital or analog. So both of them go through the simulation process to figure out that what is the actual performance or the functional throughput of the design circuit. And in both the processes, once you have reached a certain step, then before proceeding to the next one, you definitely need to have a sign of check whether the at least whatever stage you have reached, it still matches to the required specification. That's where the formal verification comes into the play. So all those RTL or the circuits, they kind of get checked against to the very much early RTL entry which were made or to the analog specifications. Okay. So this is the handoff from where we'll be going from the front end segment to the back end segment. And once we have passed through the stage and we are kind of entering the physical design space, then I think you guys have must gone through in the previous sessions that what all these terms mean, like silicon, virtual prototyping, power planning, floor plan, time budget, constraint generation, block level and chip level, physical design implementation, signal integrity closure, physical customization, etc. So all this process is actually a design implementation done in the physical domain, where a lot more categories of parameters are added, which needs to be cross-checked at each and every stage. Like once you do PG grid optimization, then you go for clock tree synthesis, you need to take care of congestion, you need to take care of the routing conversions. So a lot of parameters are there. And all the same process is done through the lot of flows and scripts in the physical design of the digital circuit. Whereas in the physical design implementation of the analog circuits, it's mainly layout capturing which happens and the circuit extraction happens. So once you have done both of them, then you kind of proceed for the chip assembly. Once you have assembled the chip and all the IPs or the digital circuits implemented through physical design, they're integrated, then you start running all your sign-off checks. So all these things are actually a parallel thing. I mean, it does never happen that once you're done RTL entry, then it's only a one-way traffic taking you through the tape out. So many a times it happens that you are at the chip assembly and sign-off stage and you figure out that some feature is still not working as per expectation based on RTL simulation feedback or gate level simulation feedback. Sometimes gate level simulation may take 30 days also. So in those circumstances, what happens is, of course, you can reach up to your chip assembly and sign off. In parallel, you'll get a feedback that some RTL needs to be enhanced. So then those things can be integrated using a ECO process that is called engineering change orders. So a minor piece of code gets changed, and then that goes through resimulation, resynthesis, and a minor change in the physical design implementation of that particular code. And still you can continue with your chip assembly, and then the parallel leg will be integrated into your mainstream one. So this cycle kind of continues through the all the development is happening. Like when RTL entry reaches up to 45, maybe 50%, you can start this circuit design cycle so that you can prepare your environment, prepare your scripts, identify the risk areas, identify which particular specification is stressing the design much, whether it's frequency or area or power. So all those feedbacks kind of go back and forth. Sometimes it happens that you do chip assembly and you're not able to clean up your design from the STA perspective. Then also you give this feedbacks to the RTL owners or the designers and take their suggestion to mitigate that issue. Okay, so this is still the briefing of the ASIC design flow and specifically into the digital and analog circuit flow. Now, before we proceed on to the next slide, which will be a deep down of the physical design, before we go into sign up, the floor is open for any kind of questions if you guys have.
Till now, actually, there isn't any question in the chat box. If any participants have any question, you can ask too, sir.
So guys, feel free to ask any kind of question. We are all engineers at same level, so don't hesitate. I think once you you open up, then we can discuss it in a lot more depth. Okay, fine. I'll proceed with the next slide. And meanwhile, you can keep populating the checkbox so that before the next slide ends, we can discuss it in details. So within the ASIC design flow, you must have learned what place and route of the physical design segment needs as input and what it produces as output. So these are the some of the important files which are the output of the PNR cycle. And out of all these files, only one that goes to the foundry, that is OSS. So this OSS is the GDS, that is a geometric design, which contains the stream. And foundries like TSMC, Intel, Samsung, they will use it based on the technological node, and they will manufacture silicon out of it. So if we just need OSS, then why do we need all these parameters like Verilog netlist, library exchange format, standard Peraspeak exchange format, or the design exchange format? Why do we need all this? Does anybody have idea based on your previous sessions? Okay, so that's what is called as sign-off. So once you kind of provide OSS or GDS to Foundry, you want to make sure that it matches to your design exchange format, your parasitics, your library exchange format, and your logic design format. So it should be the case where a Verilog, which is final outcome of your PNR process, that and your OSS should be 100% compatible, right? So before the foundry only takes this for manufacturing the masks, and based on that silicon, the dyes and everything. So if they need OSS, then it becomes our guarantee that matches to the logic design which we have done, and the parasitics and the DAF, right? Because all these formats, they are required to kind of do sign-off checks of different aspects, like power verification, physical, STA, LEC, all those things. So I think this is the cycle which you guys have seen in the previous sessions, like initialization, placement, CTS, post-CTS, route, post-route, and then you go for all this sign-off checks, right? So for all the sign-off checks, the inputs are many, right? Then you go through PNR, and then once again, you dump out modified Verilog. So whatever was the input Verilog, that kind of gets modified, right, in the process of PNR. So that's where the sign-off checks plays role. So you run through LEC and ensure correctness of the functionality. So these are some of the sign-off checks that I will be discussing with you, that what are the inputs and what are the expectations set from each of those sign-off checks. So IRDrop is the dynamic voltage drop analysis or static voltage drop analysis. Then you have to do electromigration checks also as part of it. And logic equivalence check is the one which we discussed just before. Caliber is the physical verification. So your design must be clean from layout versus schematic checks, antenna, ERC, DRC. There are a lot more checks, but I think these are some of the major ones. Extraction kind of produces parasitic delay information, which gets back annotated to your netlist. and you can figure out that how much of each timing path consumes in terms of delays. It basically produces R and C values of each and every net of your netlist, right? And STA is the static timing analysis, which ensures that the frequency which was mentioned, that is getting met, at least from the static timing point of view, right? So I think these three are the main things, like how you feed it into the PNR cycle and what you get out of it. And then there has to be means of making sure that the OSS which gets delivered to the foundry that matches to all the formats of your design representation, right? So that's been one of the major items that we'll be discussing. So yeah, before I do deep dive into any of the signups, let me know if you guys have any questions so far.
Not yet, sir.
Okay, sure. Now let's get into the first one. So I think this is what we discussed up front, that in the process of physical design implementation, your netlist gets modified, right? So you wrote an RTL code, which kind of went through the synthesis. At synthesis time, there was a kind of a NAND gate, which gets converted into some sort of XNOR or NAND invert gate and stuff like that. So you need to ensure that it still is the same what you gave to the physical design tool, right? You had a one buffer and those gets transformed into two inverters. So there has to be a mechanism to make sure that whatever gets feeding, that is still not breaking your functionality. It's still intact for you. You can do timing checks, you can do power verification, physical verification, but at most important thing is your logic equivalence has to be maintained, right? So in PNR, you will be doing like placement optimization, you will be sizing cells, you will be cloning cells, you will be adding buffers, inverters, everything. There will be multi-million gates, but there has to be a process to make sure that it still is equivalent to what was your base functionality supplied. So logic equivalence check is the sign off for that. For that, we use multiple tools, like from Synopsys, it's a formality, and from Cadence, it is LEC tool. So conformal LEC. So these two are the main industry sign of tools which we use for logic equivalence check. And in case if you are using a low power design, likewise you have power domains, then you need to sign off your CPF or UPF file as well. So you supply your power intent file, that which domains are turning on, which domains are turning off, where the isolation cells are, where are level shifters. That definition also gets integrated along with your logic equivalence check. And that will tell you whether your design is meeting the power intent or not, right? So power intent is the way of telling tool that this is the actual expectation of the power domain implementation. Based on that, tool knows that which segments are requiring isolation cells, which particular interfaces need level shifters. So all those are based on the IEEE standards 1801. So that's called the UPF.
Sorry for the, okay. Continue, sir.
No problem. So the power intent is supplied along with the logic equivalence check, and that's where we can do VCLP or conformal low power checks. It's also a logical check which makes sure that your design or netlist are clean and they match precisely the power intent that is supplied. Okay. So any other questions on LEC? Nothing, I guess. Then I'll move ahead.
No questions yet, sir.
Sure. Okay, then let's move to timing sign-off. So timing sign-off is a very detailed segment. I mean, there are special...
Sir, there is one question from Mrs. Nilima that can you highlight on low power check using ATPG?
Low power checks using ATPG. So, okay. So, ATPG is automatic test pattern generation, right? So, test pattern generation is part of the DFT integration. So, DFT has a separate sign off process wherein what they try to do is they try to do this scan chain stitching and the memory-based controllers are getting inserted. And once those are inserted, then there are certain checks performed that many of the checks are there, but just to give an idea, they kind of run through a vector insertion in your scan chain. And based on that scan chain's output, they try to figure out if there are any manufacturing defects or not. So, when you're designing a chip, then this scan chain integration, your BIST controllers, your cut point, your test points, all those gets inserted, and you prepare a set of vector. When actual silicon is provided by foundry, at that time, what they do is they put this bare dies onto the test equipments, and they run through the same vector which they had designed earlier. And with the help of these vectors, they can figure out if a particular segment on a die is working or not. So ATPG is the test pattern generation, and these patterns are generated quite early enough. And once the silicon is out, these test patterns are used to figure out which segment of die is not working. Right? So that's how the process works. So it's not that the tape out is done and silicon is back, then the cycle is over. It never happens that way. So once the tape out is done, then you have to go through the chip bring up and yield analysis. Out of 100 die, how many dies are actually working? And if they're not working, then you need to have a solid reason also, right? Because each die is costly. So that's where DFT or design for test comes into the play. They do a lot of work to bring up the chip and figure out which part is not working, which is working. And ATPG scan, a lot of things are there with which they are able to pinpoint the failure reason, that which part of the silicon is not working.
Sir, another question is there from Dr. Suresh Kumar. Will this LEC and all involves coding or just automatic process in the tools?
So LEC is the process where you give two netlists, one before PNR and one post PNR, right? So one is your golden and second is revised. And along with it, in each and every ASIC design flow, you provide constraint. So of course, there will be a small script, and tool will internally run through static vectors, and it will push through them. Once the vectors are passed through, then it knows that if, let's say, we take this scenario, this was a buffer, And if this turns out to be a one inverter and a buffer, then tool knows that while passing one from zero, it received inverted signal here. Whereas in this case, when passing one from here to here, it received the same signal, same unit. So that's what LEC does internally on both the netlist. It does it on both. This is kind of golden netlist. This is revised netlist. So it runs through vectors from each of the inputs and checks the output, what is output available on this node in the golden. For revised also, it also propagates same vectors and checks if you got the same output or not. So for LEC process also, it's a...
Just a minute. All the participants, I would really like to request you to maintain the dignity of the session. Without any knowledge of your mic is being unmuted and it is creating a disturbance to the expert. So please, I request you to maintain the dignity of the session. Okay, sir. Continue, sir.
Right. So LEC process, this golden and revised netlist, both are going through the static vector insertion and then they get cross-verified for the output. And that's how it figures out whether one buffer became two inverter, that is still okay. But if one big buffer becomes an inverter and a buffer, then it will flag it. And it will pinpoint you this area, that this is the place where the signal change is happening compared to the golden. And you can easily fix it if that's the case. Does that answer the question that was raised?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other questions before we jump into
sir.
STA?
Right now, only two questions were there, and they both are answered. Okay, sir.
Sure. Timing sign off. So, now you have got your LEC clean, so you are at least good to go for the timing sign off. So, before going to timing sign off, you will be required to perform extraction of your design. So you have a logic functionality available through the means of NAND, and that is verified against your RTL that it matches through LEC. Second input, which is foremost required, is the extraction files. So your design, you have all these nets, right? So each and every net should be kind of presented in forms of R and C delay. So resistance value and capacitance value. And STA tool will calculate its RC delay value based on the different conditions. So there are two ways timing sign-off can be done, static timing analysis and the dynamic timing analysis. So we will look at static timing analysis. Dynamic timing analysis is generally not performed. It's dynamic timing analysis is rather called simulation with the SDF. And that is very long process. You can see the comparison here. It's highly accurate, but it's slow in runtime. I mean, it's not possible for whole chip. It will take maybe months to complete a cycle. So static timing analysis, on the other hand, is it's a pessimistic, but it's comparatively possible. I wouldn't say it's fast, but it's possible. And it's formula-based, like setup, hold, and all those things. So main difference between static and dynamic are anyway listed here. But what we generally perform is static timing analysis. And inputs that are required for static timing analysis, they are mainly the netlist, then your SPEF file, which is the back annotation for the delay, then your liberty files and your design constraints, like what is your clock, what are your timing exceptions, what are your requirements. And nowadays, with the advent of the technology, we use OCV parameters also. Like generally we use nowadays POCV, which is parametric OCV. to take care of the on-chip variation.
Okay.
So,
sir.
I think there's some disturbance. Can you mute yourself, please? Okay. So, so along with the netlist, parasitic extraction files, liberty files, constraints, we also need OCV parameters that are on-chip variation files. So nowadays we run multi-mode, multi-corner, and a lot of OCV parameters are also embedded there. That way we can make sure that when a silicon is manufactured, it takes care of all the variation while doing the manufacturing. So you know, right? I mean, if you are building two separate dishes, but the taste of one and the taste of second might be a little different, it's very hard to identify that, but then the amount of a recipe which you put in may differ at a extent of 0.001%, right? So that 0.1% actually translates into a dye failure. So it is not possible for us to figure it out, but we can cover it by means of on-chip variation parameters. You know that there is a, let me take you to the first slide. I think there's some picture there, yeah. So if you look at this particular picture, it's a picture of a wafer, and wafer can have hundreds of dyes in it. This small squares in it, they are dyes. So when we are manufacturing this dyes on a wafer, each and every dye may not have same manufacturing process. There might be variation at the level of 0.1% or 0.0001%. But you want to still make sure that a dye sitting on the leftmost top of the wafer and the dye sitting on the rightmost bottom of the wafer still is possible to kind of perform same set of operations. So we use on-chip variation to account for such variation, which is spatial and kind of random as well as geometric, right? So geographically, these two guys are separate, so they can have a different manufacturing process. But with OCV, we can at least cover them, right? So that is one of the other important aspects of the timing sign off, what all inputs we get. And and synopsis to prime time is industry standard for this one. So it is standard for the STA. And once it's signed off using the correct recommendations from Foundry, we can make sure that all the corner cases of the manufacturing process from the timing point of view are covered. Okay. Any question before we get a little deep into STA? I guess there are no questions, so we'll move ahead. Okay. So when we run static timing analysis, we partition our design into mainly four type of paths. So one can be an input which feeds to register. So that is called input to register path. Second is register to register. And third one is register to output. And then there can be another one, which is kind of from input to the output. So all these paths are analyzed for their setup and hold requirement. So setup is the state where this latches change their state. So we want to make sure that before that state comes, the signal must be stable. And that decides our optimization period. Like you will be able to reach 500 megahertz, 600 megahertz, 1 gigahertz, 5 gigahertz. So that becomes actually a period of optimization, right? So like 1 gigahertz is 1 nanosecond of time frame. So all the logic has to be optimized for that 1 nanosecond. So a signal changing from Q before it reaches to D, it can't consume more than 1 nanosecond if you want to meet 1 gigahertz of frequency, right? So that is very important to understand. That is because that is directly linked to the performance of your chip. I mean, if you put too much of logic and you can't meet 1 gigahertz, which is the spec defined, then you'll have to modify the design. There is no other alternative available. So setup is mainly to identify whether you are able to propagate signal through the logic within the specified time. And once the latches are getting changed, you need to hold the signal for a certain amount so that it doesn't get into metastable state. That's where the THD comes into the play. So that is the hold time requirement. So each and every path, which is categorized like this in the chip, there can be billions of paths. Millions, I don't know how many paths will be there. So all those paths are analyzed by static timing analyzer tool. And then it tells us that these are the failing paths, right? So those all those failures must be fixed before we kind of proceed for the next stage. So that is the timing analysis. And along with that, because the geometries are shrinking, we also need to look at the crosstalk analysis. So when nets are routed very close by, nowadays with 5 nanometer designs, there can be multiple types of capacitance, like cross coupling, cross over, cross under, fringe capacitance, ground capacitance. There are many terms, right? So all of those capacitances play a role. So what they can do is when, so both the signals, whichever has a weaker transition, it becomes a victim. Which one has fast or aggressive transition, that becomes aggressor. So aggressor can impose cross-coupling charges onto the victim. And in that process, it can influence the signal. So it is possible that signal may turn out to be a fast switching, or it may turn out to be a slow switching signal. So once the crosstalk is embedded under the victim, it can introduce a glitch into the signal, and that can change the functionality. If it's a zero, the glitch can convert it into one. So that can be disastrous for your chip, right? And other things what it can do is, other than glitches, it can kind of delay the signal or speed up also. So it can do both of those things. So crosstalk has to be analyzed in a similar fashion, like static timing analysis. And it needs to be treated a similar way. So it has to be fixed, right? So these are the couple of important parameters where we need to take care of those and fix them accordingly based on the STA feedback. Along with this, there will be a lot of other checks also involved, which will guarantee like transition checks, then the capacitance check. Those will guarantee that the limits specified in the library, the .lib files, they are not violated. So I think this is a very interesting topic. And once you run through this, you'll get to know that what is the degree of involvement in it and the degree of complexity, because this is one of the major items which kind of drags the tape out, right? So it needs a lot of calculation as well. The engineer who are owning static timing analysis, they generally had to do a lot of calculation. I mean, how to fix a path, how to speed up a path, how to speed down a path. If you want to fix setup, you need to speed up. If you want to fix hold, you need to speed down, right? So many of such parameters are there, and static timing analysis engineers kind of give this feedback so that the physical design engineers can fix it. So PD engineer needs to know everything. They need to know LEC, STA, each and every sign off they need to know. And sometimes if the chips are large, there can be dedicated engineers who will handle PD, who will handle LEC, who will handle STA, like that. Okay, so this was a little brief idea for the static timing analysis. Any questions on STA or any other earlier topics?
Yes, sir. Okay. There is one question. When STA is not met, what are the steps to be followed or possibilities to overcome it?
Okay. So first and foremost, I mean, STA has to be met. I mean, we can't tape out a chip if your STA targets are not getting met. But in worst case scenario, if you are not able to meet your setup timing, you can still push it to the foundry, making sure no hold time failures. And that impacts onto the yield, right? So when we tape out, we kind of consider multiple corners, slow, fast, and hot, like slow, fast, and typical. So if you don't meet timing across all of them, but if you're able to meet timing across a few of them, then you know that the fast parts, which will come from foundry, they won't meet timing, or the slow parts won't meet. So according to that, you can take decision. But at least in my career so far, we have never taped out a chip which had a 1 PS of failure even. We don't even let go 1 PS, 1 picosecond. We fix everything till it becomes 0-0. So because that's a millions of dollars getting invested here, and if it doesn't work, then it becomes very nasty at the company level, right? So it's always desirable that you fix everything what you know about. So, and there are methods with which all these things can be fixed. The tools have become quite smart. They are very mature tools, and then there are very significant number of processes which are automated nowadays. So it just needs to be that the engineers have to be thorough with the usage of tool. If you know tool well, then you can fix it in one shot. You don't need to do iterations. So yeah, I mean, you must fix everything. You can't leave it before taping it out. Okay. Any other question?
No, sir, it was only one, and it is also being sold, so he has given acknowledgement.
Okay, sure, thank you. Let's proceed to the next set of sign-offs. Okay, so we have signed off our design from logic point of view. Second was the STA, so we know that static timing is also passing. Now we get into the physical sign-off, and first one is the PG grid sign-off, that the way your chip is designed, the way logic is placed, does it have an adequate power grid or not, right? So it is like, to very well explain this, I'll give you an example that you have a very big society, right? A very big community where you have 1,000 houses. And for each houses, you have a very thin pipe of water getting supplied to them. Just imagine if that small pipe is now getting shared between 10 houses. So in peak summer, everybody will be demanding water. Now, if you kind of change that scenario and you kind of improve that by supplying water to each houses with the same thickness of pipe. So that's what happens in the silicon design also. Like current is getting supplied from the package and power grids are your pipes, basically. And transistors are the houses, if you really want to establish analogy between them. So if you don't have an adequate power grid, the current will take a lot of time to reach to the transistors. And that is what is called the resistance, because you are trying to supply to too many transistors or a huge demanding transistors. So you need to reduce that transistor, you need to reduce the resistance of the wires reaching to all those transistors. Otherwise, you will see such type of hotspots. So in such scenarios, what you do is you get an early feedback of the IR drop analysis, and you try to figure out that which segment of a chip is hotspot, and you improve PG grid in accordance to that, or you improve the standard cell placement or the IP placement in those regions. So generally, when you have a chip operating on 1 volt, the IR drop can be always 10% of that, because that's what is generally considered in the STA, that a transition can have a 10% of drop in the voltage levels. And that drop is mainly manifested by the IR drop. So the amount of current that is getting supplied, that doesn't change, but the resistance can vary. So based on that, the drop is observed. And when you check that with the instantaneous current, like you are operating your chip, like with mobile, you're playing a game, and sometimes you're just doing a chat or you're watching a video, then the amount of operations done by the processor inside those changes, and the current required also changes. So it can lead to different variety of drops. So dynamic IR drop is of utmost importance. And if you observe a drop more than 10% in your chip, then you need to redesign the power grid. And this is, of course, not catastrophical, but it can impact on your performance as well as yield parameters. So dynamic IR drop is one of the most important parameters when we are doing power verification. And these checks are done in industry standard tool called Apache, which is from the ANSYS. And they need a lot of inputs, like package, the def of the design, all the left files, then the vectors, the power profile, everything. It's a very rigorous process, and it needs to align a lot of inputs of your design representation. So along with static and dynamic IRRAP analysis, we also do electromigration analysis that kind of guarantees the life cycle of the silicon. So electromigration parameters are different if you need your chip to be operating for 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. So it decides the life cycle of the chip. So based on that, the electromigration checks also change. So that's also part of the power verification sign-off. So that's one of the important. So any other queries or doubts related to the power verification? Or we can move to the next topic.
No, any doubts are in chat box.
Okay, sure. Now let's move ahead. Okay, this is probably the last one from sign off processes, and probably the most complex one as well, which is the physical verification sign off. So here we kind of compare the schematic to the layout. So schematic is nothing but your SPICE netlist. So the netlist which comes out of the physical design process, it's a Verilog netlist. We associate that with the SPICE netlist and create a SPICE schematic representation of it, which gets extracted, and that gets compared against the GDS. So what happens is, this is your layout, which is OSS, and this is your SPICE netlist. So if you really want to establish a sign-off process, what you do is, you are actually comparing your GDS to the RTL, because your GDS gets compared against the SPICE netlist. SPICE netlist is made up from the physical design process netlist, and that netlist we have already checked through LEC against the RTL. So this is how you actually sign off, that this LVS and LEC combined together, they become actual way of signing off and comparing your layout versus your RTL. So layout versus schematic checks will tell you if there are any shorts or opens. And the DRCs are also part of it. So they will tell you whether there are any kind of DRCs. Then there is another separate check called ERC, that is electrical rule check, design rule checks. So many checks are there. And the OSS has to be clean from this, otherwise Foundry won't accept it. So this DRC checks are the one which make sure that Foundry can really manufacture it. So it needs a lot of information about the device, how the transistors are built, how are the connectivity, how are the routing, what are the different rules, what are actual DRC rules, what are actual DFM rules. So that's a very complex area, and it needs a lot of experience and expertise of using tool. So industry standard tool for signing off physical verification is Calibre. That is from Mentor Graphics. So Mentor Graphics Calibre can do a lot of things. It can do LVS, it can do DRC, it can do antenna checks, it can perform very specific work rules, package checks, everything. So there are many of such things which Calibre can do. And before giving OSS to Foundry, this has to be made completely clean. So that is at most important, because without this, Foundry won't accept it. You have to have all this clean, and then only you'll be allowed to ship it to the Foundry. So it can take a lot of time to clean this up. And generally, correlation between the PNR environment and the sign-off environment is managed very well. But still, it needs to be worked upon. It shouldn't happen that when you go to sign off, you see thousands of failures. Otherwise, it will become a nightmare and will consume a lot of time to fix them. So it's always preferable that we kind of make sure that our environments are very well correlated, whether it be PNR or sign off. So whatever is observed in PNR, it should very well match to sign off. That's the only way you can fix it. So this physical verification process actually involves all these things, device recognition and connectivity. Then also it extracts the netlist, which is SPICE. This is also like your SPICE, and both are getting compared here. And then you get this LVS report. And if such type of shorts are present in the design, it will flag them. So once this is done, then you do a lot of other checks like density of the design, pattern matching for the memories. And then comes the DFT, which we discussed earlier, that I haven't captured here, but that's also when I have to sign off, because they also need to sign off the patterns, which will go into the tester. So as far as the sign off topics are concerned, this is all covered. I think now we can do a in-depth discussion on any of the topic which folks want. So then I had some more questions for you guys. I think this, I'll give it to the Smokster and he can share it to you. I think that's all what I had.
Yes, participants, if you have any questions, are with us, you can ask. Okay, sir, there is no any questions.
Okay.
Okay.
So once again.
Yes. Hello.
Yes. This is Suresh Kumar from Chennai, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, actually, this is a wonderful session. I must thank you for giving such a wonderful session.
Thank you.
As an academician, I have an interest to learn all these tools. So can you suggest me how I could learn all these tools, or is it only for industry persons, or for doing research? How can, or up to what level I need to learn this kind of tools? So basically, we know up to RTL, synthesized layout design, DRC checking, all this basic, up to basic we know. To move to the next level, can you suggest something?
So generally with academia, all this industry standard tool companies, which are called EDA companies, electronic design automation companies like Synopsys, Cadence and Mentor, they have collaboration with majority of the universities where they give their tools for academic purposes. Along with their tools, they give all the reference manuals and the test design as well, which is a very small design.
Amin?
you can use those for learning purposes. So that's where they kind of give this complete flow also, like a tickle-based flow. And you can go through that complete cycle on your own based on the some requisition kits are there. So it just needs to get through a stage that you need to figure out that what is the collaboration of the particular university you are belonging to with this EDA companies. And you know that engineers are not prepared in industry, they're prepared in the universities, right? So universities must have such type of infrastructure where students and the professors can go through the industry standard implementation practices. So this should be available. And once it is available, then you can go through those trials on your own and get more knowledge out of it.
Any
but
more?
This electronic design is a very lucrative segment of the industry. And majority of the people involved in it, at least they are able to do cutting edge work.
Yes, any more questions?
Sir, if you are jumping from 2 nanometer to 1 nanometer technology, so what are the design part or where exactly we need to take it? Basically, which part of the design or simulation or layouts or where exactly we have to worry while jumping from different nanometer technology?
It changes everything. You need to worry at all aspects because, see, what you are changing is, first of all, is the channel length, right? So when you talk about 16 nanometer going to, let's say, 7 nanometer, what we are telling is we are shrinking the design. So it kind of becomes a very basic building block gets changed for you. If you are a mason and a brick changes for you, you know, right, what all will have to be taken care of. So transistor is kind of the basic building block for us. And if transistor gate length changes, then a lot of other things changes. So I have started my career working on 180 nanometer technology. And today I'm working on 5 nanometer. In between, I have worked on 130 nanometer, 90 nanometer, 65, 45, 28, 16, 7, and now 5. So I'll tell you, it is completely different paradigm. Even if I compare 16 nanometer versus 5 nanometer, it's a dramatic change. So you have to be a lot more cautious in designing your power grid. You have to be a lot more cautious in designing your RCs. STA becomes a really complicated thing because of crosstalk and all this shrinking geometries. It takes huge time to decide on all these parameters. Huh? Where it helps is it improves the performance like frequency and power. But the job becomes too critical. So it needs a lot of study and analysis. Both things are needed at the same time. When you migrate from one technology node to another.
It doesn't save the time of a designer.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
When going from high to low nanometers, it doesn't save the time to design and all.
No. So why would you go from geometric technological node to another one? Is, of course, you want to improve one certain aspect of frequency, right? So let's take case of kind of a mobile phone which you were using 10 years back and what you're using now, right? So 10 years back, when we had mobile phone, at that time the functionality that it served was probably calling, texting, calculator, and stuff like that, right? So the amount of functionality involved was very small, and you were able to charge it and use it for 3-4 days. Now what it supports is fantastic, right? You name the thing and it supports you. If you want to watch a YouTube video, you want to listen to music, you want to do calculations, you want to note down things, you want to play games, you want to do video calling, a lot more functionality gets added. And then, of course, it drains out in a day or 1.5, right? So with the advent of technology, it is possible to achieve all this functionality on the same chip. That's why it's called a system on chip. So if you keep asking for more, you will have to have a supporting infrastructure also, right? So that's why transistor has to be made faster. It has to be made less leakier. It has to be made less power hungry. So, and with all this, it also increases heat dissipation. So now the chips which were 10 by 10 earlier, now they have become 2 by 2 in size. So the amount of heat they produce is too high. You might be aware that some of the data centers from Microsoft, Google, they are in the undersea. You know the reason why people like to keep their data centers either in the Arctic region or the sea is purely because of the weather. The amount of heat that is dissipated, that is directly absorbed. Nobody keeps data center in India, right? Specifically in western part of India, like Gujarat or Rajasthan, nobody will put their data centers there. They will melt. If you are already dissipating 100 plus degrees centigrade of heat, and your surrounding is also burning at 45 degrees centigrade, then your systems are going to melt. So it's all depending on what you want to achieve and what all parameters you need to consider. So there is a lot of involvement at each and every level. I told, right, we started from specification. So people consider all these things, that where is the actual end market? I mean, look at automotive. If you are buying any car today, you have infotainment system, right, in it. Whether it's a small car or be it a Mercedes or any other car, you have a infotainment system. But if you even consider your fuel injection, that is also now controlled by the silicon. Now, assume you are kind of having automatic car, then your fuel injection is controlled by silicon. And you can imagine that in the automotive chips, they are in a difficult environment. Like you will be having a fuel injection system, your motors and everything. And when you open up your bonnet, that it's always heating, right? So when you are designing a silicon, whether it's for whichever market, you have to consider that which are the operating conditions for it. So we sign off considering minus 40 degrees as well as 125 degrees. So we consider extremes, and that actually impacts onto your transistor performance. It can increase delay, it can kind of reduce the life cycle, it can increase power. Many parameters are there. So now once you have built a Mercedes, you can't change the fuel injection system of it, right? You can't change its infotainment system just because of one IC not working. So, and okay, all these things are at least manageable. Just imagine a Boeing 737. The operating system within it, if it doesn't perform the way it was expected, then it will be a disastrous thing, right? And nowadays, you just name a machine. Majority of those will have at least one working silicon inside them. So from mobile phones to the aeroplanes or any other thing for that matter, you take it, it'll have one or two small ICs within them. So that's why if you're building such a complex and heavy system, you also need to make sure that it performs without any glitches in it. Just think about an aeroplane. If it gets a glitch, it can, and there has been many catastrophes also, right? So when you design a system, it's of course $1 million investment, but apart from it, it's also a very responsible thing. You can't just design it for sake of designing, because it depends which end market it is into. So going from one technology node to another, it is a matter of the end market where the chip is going to actually work. So automotive chips and all those, they are still getting designed at mature technology nodes like 90 nanometer, 130 nanometer, because you know that they are not going to fail.
Okay, any more questions? Okay, sir. I think we no more questions. So thank you, Kasyap sir. You have spared your valuable time from your busy schedule. I know, sir. I understand. So thanks once again, behalf of Government Engineering College, Rajkot, myself, Hasmukh Koringa, coordinator of this event, and thanks you once again, sir. You have spared your time. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone, for listening patiently. Okay. I really appreciate that.